Hello everyone, welcome back. This is part two of the lesson on Jainism. We ended with a summary of the worldview model, and so now let's use that model to explore the tradition of Jainism. All right, the world universe. They, first of all, endorse this idea of samsara, which you will remember from Hinduism and Buddhism, right? It's thought of, time is not thought of as linear, like in the Western traditions of Christianity, Judaism, and Islam. Time is not thought of as linear, but rather cyclical, and it runs throughout eternity. And basically, time is more seen like a wheel rather than a straight line. And in this wheel, there are six spokes, which represent the different ages. And they're about 21,000 years each, and they designate which way things are moving morally. Now, what do I mean by that? Well, imagine a wheel with six spokes, and on the top of the wheel are three spokes, on the bottom of the wheel are three more spokes. And the top spokes represent positive moral behavior in the universe. And the bottom spokes represent negative moral behavior in the universe. And so things are either, since this wheel keeps turning, things are either eternally heading towards moral improvement or moral depravity and decadence, right? So now, if you were to ask a Jain now, we are thought to be in the fifth stage, heading downward, the Kali Yuga, right? So things are getting worse, and they have been getting worse for a while. And according to Jain doctrine, when the sixth stage arrives, there's going to be no more attaining Kavala. There's going to be no more finding omniscience until the wheel keeps rotating and starts moving the positive three spokes upward again. Right? As long as we're headed downward, in that last stage, there's going to be it's not enlightenment necessarily, it's kind of omniscience, right? No one else is going to attain omniscience and be able to escape the cycle until the wheel starts moving upward again. Now, this raises an interesting question. If no liberation is possible in the late fifth and sixth stages of the world cycle, then why on earth should we be religious, right? What's the point? If we're kind of all just kind of screwed, well, what's the point of being religious? Well, Jainism has an answer, and it has to do with karma and loka. The loka is the name that they give kind of for the physical universe. Its size is pretty incalculable, right? But according to the Jain tradition, it kind of takes the shape of a torso of a man. And they call it Purusha. And in this loka, in the universe, are all living beings that have always existed and always will, right? And like I mentioned, it's circular, it's cyclical. And so the universe, it takes this one shape, but it hasn't been created by like a personal creator God in the same way that Jews believe that the world was created by Yahweh, in the same way that Christians believe the world was created by God and Muslims by Allah, that those are personal gods who take an active interest in human lives and intervene at points in the linear unfolding story. That's not really what's going on in the Jain or really the other Asian traditions. It's less of a personal creator God and more of just like a moral force, an impersonal force. Right, and so there are in the universe, in the loka, there are different areas, and there is one area called the middle realm, and that kind of houses all the humans. In India, in that middle realm, India of the present, they are presently stuck in the morally downward world cycle, as I just mentioned. Right, this is the fifth world cycle headed for the sixth, but there are other areas that you can die here, die in India, or die in the, you know, the physical world, and get reborn into if you live well, right? So karma is absolutely a feature of Jainism. And so the Tirthankaras and people who achieve Kavala live in this other place. And if you live your life well now, you can be reborn into that other area from which liberation and escaping the cycle is possible. Okay, so there are three areas of this middle realm, the present and India and the you know, the physical universe is one of them. This other area from which you can be liberated is another. And then there's kind of a third area, which it's sort of like an underworld, but that's not really a Sanskrit word. It's when it's described, they talk about clouds. The closest analog to the Western religions is kind of this idea of hell, for instance. But notice, even after death, people's karma can move them from one area to another. And so these are relevant features of the world. And so they're important to mention in the worldview model. Now, in the world and universe, there are different categories of existence, right? The jiva, which is the living, you can translate this as, you know, roughly a soul. It might be analogous to the Atman in Hinduism, and Buddhists don't actually believe we have a soul, but you can imagine the jiva as the souls, right? And then, so imagine that, but souls, notice, souls are not limited to humans. They are adamantly pro-life in Jainism. And so souls might be found in a tree or in a plant or in a person or an animal. Now, this is different than the ajiva or the non-living matter. And this includes things like motion, rest, atoms, and space. And the idea is that the living joins the non-living to create everything that exists, each retaining its individuality. And so even though Jainism and Hinduism hasn't had as much overlap as Buddhism and Hinduism, the idea here is that the world is created by joining the living with the non-living. And so each retains its individuality. This isn't like Hinduism's monism, where everything kind of merges into God or becomes or is recognized as a God, right? This is kind of the merging of two different areas that retain their individuality. All right, now that we've gone into some of the history, the legend, and now that we've talked about the worldview model, now you'll be in a position to understand some of the facts, right? All right, so first the name. Jainism comes from the Sanskrit word jina, which means the conqueror. And so a Jain is a follower of the conqueror. And you can think of Mahavira as the conqueror. He conquered the forces of life, including his inner forces. And so contrary to all of his instincts and desires, you know, the instincts that you and I have all the time to eat meat or to just think about ourselves and not other lives, right? He conquered all this. And so a Jain is a follower of the conqueror. And so the founder, you need to know, is Mahavira, who's considered kind of the great hero. All right, how many are there? Well, we think there are in between 5 and 6 million Jains in the world, 5 million of whom live in India. And we think there are, you know, 6,000 or so Jain monks. And these are the ones who really practice Jainism and practice it with their full lives. And we think there are about 275,000 living outside of India. There's a strong population of Jains in the country of Kenya, for instance. And even American cities like Chicago have a Jain temple. And so Jains have had, even though there's only 5 to 6 million of them, they actually, their influence has been greater than you would think by just looking at those numbers. All right, what about their symbols? Well, Jainism didn't have a symbol for thousands of years, but on the 2500-year anniversary of Mahavira's death, the Jains got together and they thought they would come up with one. And so here you can see right here, this is the new symbol that they chose. And as I mentioned, you remember the universe has the symbol or has the shape of a torso, right? And so that is the shape they gave their symbol. The dot at the top has to do with liberation. That's seen as the head. The three dots are those Jain principles that we mentioned before, non-absolutism, non-violence, right? And then notice too that there's a swastika. Now, I need to say this in every class. For those of you who are not familiar with seeing a swastika in a religious studies class, let me just you know, calm your fears. This has nothing to do with the Third Reich, has nothing to do with Nazi Germany. The swastika in ancient Asian faiths, at least, didn't have anything to do with hatred or intolerance, right? It had to do with peace and stuff like that. All right, the last part of this symbol is the hand. This is both a blessing and a warning. You can think of this part of the symbol, the hand being up, as both a hello and as a stay away, right? There are spokes for each leader and ahimsa. The principle of nonviolence is there. Yeah, so this is the symbol of Jainism. And it's kind of fascinating, I think. All right, what about their scriptures? Well, when you're talking about their scriptures, you're talking about the Agamas. They're also known as the precepts or treatises, etc. And these are believed to be the actual sermons or teaching of Mahavira to his disciples. Now, there is a difference of opinion between Jains on which Agamas are authoritative, right? And there are two main Jain sects, S-E-C-T-S, that, may disagree on which writings are authoritative. Only some of these have been translated into English, and so hopefully in the next several decades, we can get some of these sacred texts fully available to those in the West so that they can study this fascinating tradition. All right, finally, let's talk about Jainism in the transformation model. You'll remember that Jains had a few beliefs. I've mentioned that they believe in samsara, or the never-ending cycle, which they understood to be kind of like a wheel that keeps rotating. They also believe in karma, which is the moral law of cause and effect, and they believe that we are currently in a downward moral cycle. And so the goal, if those are the problems, if the problem is that we can't keep going around this wheel forever, infinitely, and if living in this world kind of stains us with karmic residue, how do we get out? How do we get out of this? Well, the goal is to escape that cycle by purifying one's life. As I mentioned, that's possible only when you first attain Kevala, only when you first get the omniscience that gives you the knowledge on how to be liberated. So once you gain that knowledge, you still have to live your life. And so you'll reach the point of Kevala, and then you might, like Mahavira, live another 30 years and then be liberated upon your death, or achieve moksha when you die. So if the problems were the cycle and karmic residue and this downward moral cycle, and the goal is to escape all that, how do you do it? Well, the answer Jains give is that you can take these five vows. These are the five vows of Jainism, and they are extreme. If you were to do all of them, they are extreme. Extreme asceticism of the five vows. First, never harm anything. Like I said, this is why they strain water. This is why they brush the road that they're walking on so as not to step on an insect. This is why they wear a mask on their face. Even pre-pandemic, Jain monks wear masks on their face because they don't want to risk breathing in an insect, right? They are very pro-life. Never harm anything. That's the first vow. The second vow is always tell the truth. The third vow is never steal property, right? You'll notice that these, at least telling the truth and not stealing, resonate deeply with the Ten Commandments in Judaism and Christianity. Now, the first three of these are kept by all Jains. All Jains strive to be vegetarians, not harm anything. All Jains strive to tell the truth, and they strive to never steal property. But monks will keep all five, which means monks will avoid sexual contact, and they will avoid material attachment. So these are the five vows. Monks keep all five, laity keep the first three. Now, there's an interesting question we could ask any religious community that tries to avoid sexual contact. And that question is this: how do you expect to survive? Because the human race is pushed forward through sexual contact, right? How does this religion intend to survive if the people who are most dedicated are not having children? And this is it's actually an interesting question for all religious traditions. How do you pass the faith on? Now, for Jains, this means that if they're avoiding sexual contact, then they're not having children. So the people who end up becoming the monks, becoming the nuns, the people who have the extreme asceticism of all five vows, they end up choosing it. They weren't born into it. They might be born a Jain, but they're not born a monk. They have to choose to do this. And so someone who is a Jain monk is extremely dedicated to their faith. All right, last thing I'll say is that this is an image, a visual representation of what a Jain looks like. It has their five vows right there. And this tradition has actually featured into some great American art. If you don't know this book on the right, it's by a guy named Philip Roth, who was a great American novelist. And this book won the Pulitzer Prize. And there's actually a character who is kind of a terrorist in, several decades ago, this character was a terrorist. And this character ends up turning her whole life around and becomes a Jain and practices extreme nonviolence. It's a fascinating story. If you get the chance to read this novel, I strongly encourage it. All right, that's all I wanted to cover about the religion of Jainism. If you have any questions or comments, you know how to get a hold of me. And thank you for watching.